Hello and welcome to the Waynesburg Effect, the only political talk show on WCTV. On this episode, we're going to discuss all things about the 2020 presidential election. We'll start with talk about the last 10 days or so on the Democratic side, discussing the Nevada caucus and the latest debate, and then move on to upcoming contests like South Carolina and the ever-important states of Super Tuesday. We'll also sit down with 2020 hopeful Sam Robb, who is running to be the Libertarian Party presidential nominee. I'm Mitch Montani, and today I'll be joined on the desk by Andrew Rhea, Mike Capelli, and Jared Wiker. Sit back and relax, because it's time for another episode of the Waynesburg Effect. It's been an eventful couple days in the Democratic race for President of the United States. Bernie Sanders was the victor in the Nevada caucuses, winning just under 47% of the vote. Ended up a little bit of a blowout, much to what we didn't believe was going to happen. We thought it was going to be a lot closer than that, but Bernie Sanders with a large win in Nevada. We also saw a recent Democratic debate before the South Carolina primary. I'll turn it to the panel, and guys, what's your analysis of what we've seen over the last couple of days, including the results from Nevada and the debate ahead of the South Carolina primary?
So here's what I learned from exclusively Nevada. We've learned that whether you're considered whether you consider yourself a moderate or a progressive, it hasn't really had an effect on how the results turn out, because the labels that they put on themselves and each other have had no effect on how the voting's been turning out, because Bernie Sanders is labeled as a progressive and a democratic socialist, and he's dominating the popular vote. He's won the most votes in each of the first three states, being Iowa, New Hampshire, and now Nevada. He has more momentum than any other candidate moving forward into South Carolina. And another thing that I learned, especially about Nevada, is that no one is about to quit this race, because Joe Biden made a little bit of a surge there in Nevada, taking away 9 delegates. It's not a big stepping stone, but it's something that he can build upon going into South Carolina, where he has put a lot of his eggs into that basket. So he can build off of that going into South Carolina as well. And then Amy Klobuchar in New Hampshire, taking away 6 delegates, and then Pete Buttigieg in a distant second of Sanders with 25 total delegates. So no one's about to quit anytime soon. And heading into Super Tuesday, that could be quite interesting.
Well, you might think that nobody should quit quite soon, but really they probably should, and maybe even Mike Bloomberg after Nevada and even South Carolina, the recent debate. I mean, everybody went after Mike Bloomberg, and I was really shocked that he entered the Nevada caucus so early. He didn't even have to. He's not even going to be on the ballot, I believe, until the South Carolina primary, and Elizabeth Warren really attacked him. Warren chose to attack and destroy everyone but the person she should have, and that was Bernie Sanders. He's the main guy. It's Bernie Sanders and then everybody else. And that's for the other candidates as well. They just attacked each other. Buttigieg and Klobuchar in the South Carolina debate, they just went after each other instead of going for the main guy, Bernie Sanders. And I think it's really going to let Sanders rise to the top and really take advantage of the voting.
Yeah, I agree, Jared. That was my biggest takeaway, was that, you know, you have a guy, Bernie Sanders, who's leading in all of these polls. He's leading in, you know, every single primary or caucus that has been done already. And yet he was able to sit back and sort of relax and enjoy the lead because everyone was going after Mike Bloomberg. The strategy behind that doesn't make much sense to me. And also the strategy of how they're talking about their issues on the stage really doesn't make sense to me. Bernie seems to be the only one that really has it down in the fact that he actually gave away to fund some of the plans that he has. Now, granted, there's flaws in it, and I'll get to that in a second, but all these candidates have these giant plans of what they want to do, what they want to change, and no one's giving any sort of backing. Bernie did. However, here's the problem with it. He wants Medicare for all, correct? That's his big thing. He wants affordable health care for all Americans. Here's how he plans to pay for it. He wants a 52% tax on anyone making over $29,000. He said this in the Nevada debate ahead of the Nevada caucus. The problem with that is that he also wants to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. 15 times 40 hours a week is $600. Multiply that by 52 weeks in a year, you get $31,200. Now, with his tax to pay for health care, it's on anyone making over $29,000 a year, which anyone with a minimum wage job would be making. You take the tax out of it, you're left with $14,976. Divide that by 52 weeks, and then by 40 hours a week, and you're left with $7.20 an hour.
So why do you think the other candidates aren't exposing Bernie Sanders for all of his flaws? And you clearly just noted some.
Well,
we have a lot of candidates on the Democratic side that we've seen in the last couple of debates who are much further to the right than Bernie Sanders on this issue. Why aren't they attacking him?
That's a good question, Mitch. I don't know. And that's the thing. Even if he's sitting back and he's not giving these plans and putting numbers to these plans, I don't know why you wouldn't go after the guy who's in first. I think a lot of it is the anger at Mike Bloomberg. Mike Bloomberg's sort of the outsider in this race. He's running it purely based off of his wealth and a majority of it with his wealth and all his political ads. And I think that the main goal in Nevada, his first debate, was to attack him, to make him want to drop out and to expose him, which they did. Mike Bloomberg cannot talk. That was made very apparent. He looked rattled. He looked almost like scared on the debate stage. And it really wasn't a good look for Mike Bloomberg in Nevada. But I don't understand. I don't see Mike Bloomberg as big of a threat as I did before that debate. So I don't know why the focus hasn't shifted for people like Joe Biden, Pete Buttigieg, and Liz Warren. I don't know why the focus hasn't shifted to Bernie Sanders, because he's running away with it right now. I mean, even after this debate, very strong showing in Nevada. After the South Carolina debate, according to 538, Bernie actually gained support. He was one of three candidates to gain support after the debate in South Carolina. And he's currently, according to a Clemson poll, sitting in third place in South Carolina. Now, Biden, this is huge, because I think Biden needs to win South Carolina. He has a huge lead in the polls. He's polling at 35% according to that Clemson poll. If Biden slips up and does not win South Carolina, I think that's a huge blow to his campaign.
I'll interrupt you very briefly. We have to take a break. And when we come back, we'll discuss the South Carolina primary that's coming up, along with Super Tuesday, which is going to be very important for Bloomberg, Biden, and Bernie Sanders. We'll be back on the Waynesburg Effect. We just talked about what happened in the past. Now let's talk about what's going to happen in the future, or at least what we think is going to happen in the future. The South Carolina primary is coming up. After that, we'll have a slew of states on Super Tuesday. I'll throw it back to the panel. Jared Wiker, what do you think is going to unfold in the next couple of weeks?
Well, I think we're going to see that Bernie Sanders is going to shock people, and he's going to win South Carolina. Right now, after the South Carolina debate that just happened, the newest Economist YouGov poll has Bernie at 30%, Biden at 20%, and Elizabeth Warren at 16% for the top three. And I really think people are sleeping on Bernie supporters. I think a lot of them just don't care until the last minute. And Bernie Sanders, again, he's the top guy. Nobody's really going after him. We kind of talked about it a little bit earlier, but I mean, the moderators don't really attack him, and when they do, Bernie's able to slip out of it, and that's a credit to him, he's able to slip out of it. But also, the other candidates, again, they only attack each other. Again, in the South Carolina debate, Pete Buttigieg and Klobuchar really went at each other instead of going after Bernie Sanders. They're focusing on rivalries, they're trying to be the second guy or the third person in the rankings instead of becoming the favorite candidate.
So here's the thing. In the South Carolina debate, Amy Klobuchar went after Sanders seven times, made seven mentions of his name. Elizabeth Warren went after Sanders seven times. Pete Buttigieg went after Sanders five times. And Joe Biden went after Sanders four times. So there is some truth in the fact that other candidates are going after Sanders. But the big focus in the Nevada debate was that they were going after Bloomberg. The shift to South Carolina was that there was more attacks on Sanders, actually, from the fellow candidates. And maybe the moderators don't go after him enough, and that could be true. Maybe they probably should. But and the fact of the matter is other candidates are going after him. And looking forward to South Carolina in their primary, specifically with Amy Klobuchar and Pete Buttigieg, neither are polling well with voters of color. And this Nevada and as well as South Carolina is the time for them to back up their claims that they can appeal to those demographics, or else they're going to fall very, very, very far behind in South Carolina and then shooting into Super Tuesday. As far as Joe Biden, House Majority Whip James Clyburn just endorsed him, as we saw right after the debate, and that could have a significant impact in how he performs in South Carolina. But if Joe Biden wants to stay in this race, he's got to do well in South Carolina, because he's put a lot of his eggs in that basket. As we saw it in New Hampshire, he left New Hampshire early to go to a rally down in South Carolina.
Double-edged question. A, and I already know Drew's answer to this because he said it in the first segment, does Biden need to win South Carolina to stay alive in this race? And does Bernie have the edge in South Carolina despite all this polling? Because Bernie Sanders, in terms of polling, is a little bit like Trump was in 2016. A small, it seems like at least in terms of percentage points, a small but loyal, very loyal following of support. Will that be enough to give him the edge in South Carolina, or is it still Biden's to lose?
So Biden needs to win. Yeah, like Biden needs to win South Carolina to stay in this race, and they're gonna use that as a springboard to go into Super Tuesday. But Sanders definitely has the momentum to take it away from him, because they're looking to use South Carolina to break away wholeheartedly from the rest of the pack. Because Bernie leads right now in delegates 45. He has 45. Buttigieg has 25. Biden has 9. Klobuchar has 6. The rest have none. So if Sanders wins South Carolina, which he can, then the Sanders campaign would far and away break further and further from the rest of the pack.
Yeah, Joe Biden definitely needs to win South Carolina. But the thing is, if Joe Biden does not win South Carolina, he needs to drop out. And the same is with Pete Buttigieg and Klobuchar right now. They need to just get out of there. They're just clogging up the moderate vote for the Democrats. And they're letting Bernie Sanders, again, kind of like you pointed out, Mitch, just ride the top. He's just the best percentage. It's really similar to Trump in 2016.
I agree. I think Joe needs to win. And I think Joe's going to hold on in South Carolina. I know Bernie has a lot of momentum right now, but like you guys brought up, Joe's put a lot of eggs in South Carolina because he knows he has to win it. And Joe Biden, as much as older as he's gotten and the mistakes keep piling up and the slips of the tongue keep piling up, he's still a very competent politician.
Yes.
It's the best word for it. So I think he'll have enough strategy and enough workings to hold on to South Carolina. But I agree with Wiker where if these moderate candidates don't show anything in South Carolina, Pete sort of lost his momentum. Amy really needs to step up. If they don't, I don't see how they're going to carry anything into Super Tuesday and perform well to give themselves a chance of winning the nomination.
Quick question for all of you before we move on to Sam Robb's interview. I think this will take up a little bit of time as well. That's why I'm asking it now. Who do you guys see out of the candidates pretty much remaining? I'm not going to count Tulsi Gabbard or Tom Steyer as legitimate threats to win the Democratic nomination, but you look at all these candidates, Joe Biden, Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, Pete Buttigieg, and Michael Bloomberg. Let's just call those the core five that are left. Who of those candidates has the best chance to knock off Donald Trump in November?
Answer's obvious to me. It's Bloomberg, and it's not even close. I mean, if Bernie Sanders goes against Trump, which is looking like it will in 2020, it's going to be a landslide, a modern day landslide. I mean, it's not even close. Elizabeth Warren's even worse. Bloomberg.
I think they all stand a fairly decent chance actually against Trump because they all have a pretty, for the most part, have a decent base behind them. Amy Klobuchar and Pete Buttigieg would appeal to more moderate voters on the Democratic and Republican side. So they have that vote. Bernie obviously has the very strong left. And if he picks a good running mate, he could appeal to the moderates as well. It depends on who's on his ticket. Elizabeth Warren, I'm not super sure about her. I've heard a bunch of different things saying how she's the more palatable Bernie Sanders I personally don't agree. But if I had to put money on it, I would say Bernie Sanders has the best chance.
Best chance for me, I think, is Joe Biden still. We've mentioned it. He's getting old. But he can go into those swing states, those Midwestern states, and he can go in there and he can win. I think at least
give Democrats a chance.
Yes. I think a lot of the same is for people like Mike Bloomberg, Pete Buttigieg, Amy Klobuchar. Those moderates, I think, are your only chance to actually defeat Donald Trump. Now, I understand Bernie leading in a lot of polls has that base that we've been talking about. But Bernie Sanders is not going to walk into a state like PA, for example. You're not going to walk into PA and convince people who are focused on the economy, are focused on jobs in the energy sector, and tell them everything's going to be fine with all the plans that he's laid out. I don't think Bernie can turn Pennsylvania blue in the general election, and for that reason, I don't think he can defeat Donald Trump.
Mike, you wanted to say something very quick.
Well, so I don't think the establishment can bank on the moderates, though, because there's just people in PA, not a lot of people are focused on ideologies. They just kind of go with, oh, I agree with this, but I also agree with this, and then that's how they're going to pick their choice.
No, I agree, and a lot of the moderate candidates are unproven. There's problems with all of them. Joe Biden getting old, Mike Bloomberg, I mean, can't speak. Pete Buttigieg, very young, he has a little bit of experience being the mayor of South Bend, but not enough federal government experience for people to really trust him like someone would trust Joe Biden. Amy Klobuchar, we've seen issues in the past. I think Amy's a very strong candidate. She just needs to stand up for herself a little bit more. She's been attacked a lot by Pete, by Elizabeth Warren. She needs to stand up, and she really needs to get her voice out there. Even when she's not asked questions, I think she needs to step up and answer questions in the debate, be very proactive about it.
I got to cut you guys off there. We'll know a lot more in about a week. Super Tuesday happens less than a week from today, at least from the taping of this episode. Voting is on March the 3rd, and we'll see February the 29th, South Carolina primary results as well before that occurs. Coming up next, we will have a sit-down interview with Libertarian 2020 hopeful Sam Robb. That's next on the Waynesburg Effect.
Piracy is a crime. If you see someone downloading copyrighted material without paying for it, then you should inform the authorities immediately. If you download any copyrighted material from the internet without paying for it, then you should go to jail.
Welcome back to the Waynesburg Effect, and we have a special guest on the show today, and we are privileged to be joined by 2020 hopeful presidential candidate running for the Libertarian Party nomination, Sam Robb. Mr. Robb, thank you so much for joining.
Thank you for having me.
Drew and I on this segment of the Waynesburg Effect. I'm going to give you the floor for the first couple of minutes here in this segment. Tell us about yourself, how you got here, what your goals are in this campaign, and basically about your campaign.
Well, my name is Sam Robb. I'm from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And the reason that I'm running for president is because I was left unsupervised. I had to deal with my daughter's FAFSA forms. And I thought at that point, you know what? I bet you running for president would actually be easier than dealing with this. And it turns out that it was. So that was kind of a lark, but I've been talking about doing this for a number of years. I'd been joking about it. And I realized that the reason I was joking about it is because I was uncomfortable with the way the country was going. I didn't like the direction that the country's headed in. And as I talked to people, as I got to know people on the left and on the right and in the center, I realized that a lot of people were uncomfortable with it. And when you have that many people saying that we're going in the wrong direction, then I think it's time to change direction. So that's why I'm running for president. I want to change the direction the country's going in. I want to take us away from bigger government, more pervasive government interference in our life, and return back to a simpler time when we helped each other, when we watched out for our neighbors and our neighborhoods, and the government was something that you didn't deal with every day or have to worry about every day.
Drew?
Awesome. So you mentioned it. I hold the same belief that most Americans hold these libertarian values.
Yes.
They just don't realize it.
Absolutely.
So what's your plan, what's your view of the party as a whole, and what's sort of your plan to take libertarianism national and help people realize that, hey, this party holds a lot of the same values that I do. I just never knew about it.
That's a great question. And that's a big part of my campaign. being a Republican, former Republican from basically a blue area around Pittsburgh, I got to know a lot of people on both sides of the aisle. And I never really quite felt like I fit in. And I think a lot of Americans fall into that. They say, oh yeah, I'm a Democrat, but there's something about the Democratic Party that they like, and there's things that they don't like. Or, oh, I'm a Republican, but you know, you just have to ignore this stuff over here. A big part of the campaign this year, whether it's me or whether it's another candidate that wins the nomination, is going to be talking to those people and reaching out to them where they're at and talking to them about their problems, their concerns, and saying, hey, you know what? Government was the cause of these problems, and the solution is to get rid of government and increase our liberty and basically go back to where we used to be as a nation.
So you mentioned going to a bunch of these state conventions with the Libertarian Party. And I did notice that you got to meet Larry Sharp, and I'm a big fan of Larry Sharp.
He was an awesome man.
What was that conversation like?
I had a couple of really short conversations with him. The one that was really good was just before we left California. My wife and I had a chance to say goodbye, thank him for being there, and I'm looking forward to seeing him. He's going to be the keynote speaker in Austin. But we were talking. He said, listen, what are you going to do if you don't get the nomination? And I told him, I'm in it for the long haul. I'm here. This is my party now. You know, it's not like, oh, I'm going to switch over to Libertarian and then I'm going to switch back or anything like that. Mm-hmm. This is my home, my political home. These are my people. And he said, that's fantastic. Think about the long term. You're setting yourself up for whatever the next race is, for whatever the next challenge is, for whatever the next opportunity is, which was fantastic. I mean, coming from someone who's been there, done that, he ran for governor, hearing him say, if things don't pan out, have a plan and keep moving forward. And that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm here. I'm going to be sticking around, and you'll probably see me running for something else, either in another 4 years for a re-election campaign, or maybe sometime sooner for something at the state level.
We looked at your website, and congratulations, because your website is incredibly detailed, all kinds of different policy proposals and policy ideas, very, very specific, which impressed both of us. If you had to staple down one legislative idea or one piece of policy that embodies your campaign, what do you think it would be?
Wow. They always tell you should have 3 points.
Okay.
Three main points. My three are reduce the size of government, eliminate taxes, and reform immigration. Of those three, I think the one that is closest to my heart is reform immigration. Especially traveling and talking to people, I can't begin to tell you how many immigrants that I've run into that I'm like, oh my goodness, I am so glad you are here. I am glad you're an American. You are exactly who we want in this country. You're a go-getter. You're starting your own business. You're running your own office. You're building your new life, and you love it. That's exactly who we want here. And I don't think I'm hitting an odd sampling here of just the really happy immigrants. The people who want to come to this country want to be here because they hear about America, they understand what we stand for, and they say, hey, I want some of that. I want freedom. And I think we really should give that to them. And to do that, we're going to have to reduce the size of government. We're going to have to stop taking their money.
So this being a campus TV station, if you had to look at young voters right now and give them one reason or two or three reasons to vote for you, what would that be?
The way the country's going right now, if you look at the history of the Republican Party, if you look at the history of the Democrat Party is becoming increasingly socialist. They've got Bernie Sanders is their lead candidate right now. He is an open socialist. You've got folks in Congress that support him and that are backing him. And if you look at the history of the Republican Party lags the Democrats in terms of their policies by maybe 20 to 30 years. So in my lifetime, I expect that unless we change things, the Democrats and the Republicans are not going to be arguing over Medicare for all. They're going to be arguing about whether you should be allowed to keep some small portion of your money or if they should take everything in order to fund the government. That's where we're headed. If you're a young person, if you are, you know, in your 20s, if you're in your early 30s, and you're thinking, hey, I'm going to be raising a family, you need to start thinking right now, what kind of country do you want your children living in? Where are you going to be? Where are we going to be? And I think the answer needs to be not down that fork in the road. We need to return to a place where the economy can be great, where people can do what they want, and where we can live our lives the way that we want because we're Americans.
So I guess I'll give the floor to you at the end as well. Anything that we haven't covered that you'd like to get out there from a campaign messaging standpoint, the floor is yours before we wrap this up.
Oh, wow, fantastic. Thank you. One, thank you for having me on here. I really appreciate it. You guys are awesome, and I appreciate the opportunity. Two, from a campaign viewpoint, if you're interested, if your viewers are interested, I'd ask you to check out samrobb2020.com, samrobb with two Bs, .2020.com. Take a look at my policies. Like you said, I've explained them in detail, some of the reasons why I'm proposing the things I do. The big thing that I would like to get out, I think, is to explain that a lot of times I hear from libertarians, especially more radical libertarians, oh, you're just talking about cutting government. If I wanted to leave this room, the easiest way is through that door. There's any number of ways I could get out of here. I could crawl through the roof. I could tunnel through the floor. I could probably try and find a heating vent to crawl into. But the easiest way is to go out through that door. And it doesn't matter how far I go, I've got to go through that door. What we need to do as a country is go through that door. What we need to do as people is recognize that no matter where we're going to end up, whether that's in a place where we have remarkably little government like we did when the country was first founded, or we just return to an era, you know, back in the 30s or 40s where the government was much less pervasive, we need to go through that door. And we need to start the journey, and we need to start the journey together. We can argue along the way, and it's fun to argue. We're libertarians. That's what we do, right? It's fun to argue about where we're going to stop, but let's at least start headed towards the destination. Let's get going, and let's make it happen in 2020. Let's get that trip going.
Mr. Robb, we can't thank you enough for joining us on the Waynesburg Effect. It's not every day we get to interview a 2020 presidential candidate, so we really appreciate you taking the time, driving down here, and coming on the show, and hopefully this helps get the message out to folks that
Thank you very much.
Waynesburg University Television. Again, if you're interested in donating or checking out the Sam Robb campaign, it's samrobb2020.com. That's Sam Robb with two Bs. We'll be back on the Waynesburg Effect. To round out the show, we're going to go to our commentary segment, which happens after every episode's content is completed. And we'll start with Jared Wiker. My friend, what do you got for us?
Well, I'm going to talk about the Washington Capitals. They're not on a very good streak right now. They're 6-7-1 in their last 14 games since the All-Star break when they returned on January 27th. Washington right now has reclaimed the Metro, but they have 63 games played and 84 points. Pittsburgh in second with 61 games played and 80 points, so they're still on the tail of the Capitals. And the Caps, the story this year, bad defense and streaky goaltending. Braden Holtby, 44 games played, a 3.12 goals against average and an .897 save percentage. He has not played well, and he hasn't been the same in several years. And Ilya Samsonov, a rookie sensation so far, 24 games played, a 2.41 goals against average and a 19 and a 916 save percentage. He's played well, but he's been cold as of late. Nick Jensen and Dmitry Orlov, wow, they're pretty brutal defensively. Can the Caps figure it out and get hot? We'll have to see.
You know, Alex Ovechkin works really hard. No, he does. I think he's one of the best hockey players in the game right now. And that kind of leads into what I'm going to talk about is working hard. I believe you should always work hard on anything and everything that you do. But when you're given the opportunity, take time to relax and recuperate and reset everything so that you don't burn yourself out super quickly. Because a lot of times now what happens in our society is we're just go, and then we hit a stopping point and we just quite frankly, run into a brick wall and we just get knocked down. So I believe whenever you're given the opportunity, take time and relax to reset yourself.
I appreciate that, Mike. I actually took some time to reset myself before we got on camera. But my commentary is about the two-party system. I've talked about this before. Mitch knows. Everyone on the panel knows. I don't like the two-party system. And there's a way to end it. So first off, we need a strong libertarian candidate, much like Mr. Robb. And we very much appreciate him coming onto the show. But you need to claim at least one state in the Electoral College. New Hampshire is a fantastic opportunity with the Freedom Project. A lot of libertarians are moving to New Hampshire. You claim New Hampshire, and then you hope that neither of the two parties get a majority. When that happens, you have a month before the electors actually vote where you can look at a party like the Republicans and say, listen, you don't have a majority in the House. You give your votes to us, because you're not going to win that House vote to decide the presidency. You give your votes to us, you allow a strong, conservative, fiscally conservative candidate to win, and you don't end up with Bernie Sanders. They take that in a heartbeat. You win the Electoral College in the electors. It doesn't go to the House, and you have a libertarian president. I have a full column in the Yellow Jacket on this week, so go check that out as well.
I want to talk about how Jared Wiker looked me in the eye in November and told me the Penguins are not going to make the playoffs. Ooh. What a bad take, my friend.
And I have a bet with somebody else that I'm going to lose on that,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, you are going to lose on that bad. Since Jared Wiker made that prediction to me, the Penguins have traded for everybody and their mother, and they are two games out of first place in the Metropolitan Division of the Eastern Conference, two games back of Washington, and they have two games in hand on Jared Wiker's Capitals. So the Pittsburgh Penguins, A, Jared, are going to make the playoffs. B, they're going to compete for a Stanley Cup. And C, they are going to defeat the Washington Capitals when it matters most in the Eastern Conference second round. So
it's
I just wanted to expose that horrible take that you had a while ago.
Caps are going
to
get hot.
You're wrong, and I was right. And let's move on. Thank you for joining us on the Waynesburg Effect. Join us next time for all things political discussion and debate.
This has been a production of Waynesburg Community Television.